Monstrosity.
That's beautiful.
Anybody? You guys all have a firm grasp on what's going on there.
Left versus right. Columns.
Well, it's... This left column is all of these glazes, which sort of happens to be all these glazes.
Okay.
The right column is mostly all those glazes.
Thank you.
And it sort of worked out nicely that way. The map is here.
Okay.
All of the... Well, the main color is put on first, and then all the little strips are on top.
When they were dry? The background was
dry? Yes, yes. And then they're fired flat, so you don't get any real sense of how the glazes are going to run when gravity is more involved. So, my suggestion is, if you're doing a two-glaze combination that you've never done before, definitely keep that second coat of glaze, or that cover glaze, on the top third of the pot until you gain confidence in how much it's going to run. Then you can start moving your way down, and if you want, you know, cover the whole pot with a second glaze. But risky at first if you're not real sure. One of the things you can do to get an idea of how a glaze might run or how much they're going to melt together. I'm looking for a good example. Well, I think the red one's probably the best place to look. But then again, maybe not. Bear with me. Maybe Rutil's a good place to look. So, one of the things you can do to give yourself an idea of how much something might run is to take a look at how much that glaze is kind of fingered out or spread out. And so when we look at, you know, here's Super Tea and here's Rutil, those two have really kind of melted into the glaze and also spread out quite a bit. And so those are probably going to run in a vertical situation, right? Whereas the yellow salt and the two whites, those lines have stayed pretty crisp. And so I would say those probably aren't going to run as much. And then definitely in a situation where you can still feel that bump of the cover glaze, it's probably not going to run much at all, right? Because it hasn't even settled into the glaze underneath it much. So those are a couple of ways of telling what's happening. And then, sort of alternatively, the stacks of tiles on the shelf over there that aren't on the wall yet are the slips, and so they're labeled on the back. There's white stoneware clay with iron slip, right? Blue slip. And then the same glaze order, right? They're all in the same order, here, there, and here. And so that's what each one of those glazes looks like on top of just slip. Notice that the iron slip and the black slip aren't very different from each other until you start to get into the clear, right? So on the black slip, you're getting much more of a green color than you might off of the iron slip. Because there's chromium in here that helps make it black. Chromium is a green color, so that's where that green is coming from. Obviously no chromium in iron slip, because it's just iron.
So the iron slip with the this effect, does it always happen?
No, not always. And I would say that if you hold it so everyone can see a little bit more, up in here where you see the dark,
mm-hmm.
That's probably where the slip or the glaze was a bit thinner.
Mm.
Okay? So you've got more of the iron coming through.
Yeah.
And where it looks more like clear glaze, it's the slip was maybe a little thinner, or the glaze was a little thicker. Could be. combination of those two things happening. Yeah. Yeah. So maybe a little bit thicker on the slip and a little bit thinner on the glaze. And testing is always a really good idea. Testing, testing, testing.
Especially if you happen to like the piece you drew.
On the on the slip tiles, I tried to leave the glaze on the edge, so you can kind of get an idea of which glaze it might be without having to reference the board as much. And then the two greens, dark green, salt.
Can I see the dark greens? So the clear actually looks like a...
Yeah, that stayed pretty true. Yep. So here on this bottle, right, I've got light green slip, so I would definitely reference this so I don't lose that greenness, right? So if I were to glaze the whole thing in tomato red, well, not much is going to be left. So I'd definitely pick something that should allow that green to come through. And in this situation, you know, there really isn't many choices. You know, we've got Celadon, the two Celadons would work okay. I think the carbon trap might even be okay, right? So, you know, this copper red reading is probably not real accurate because it's hard to get the copper red as thick as it needs to be in that little strip. So a real thin copper red might let it show through, but that's, you're not going to get any red if you try to go that way. Now, that's that. These... you can get an idea of how a glaze is going to run in a vertical situation from these tiles, which I'm hoping to redo sooner than later. But you can definitely get an idea here where, I mean, this glaze, the Rucio glaze, acts very differently on different clay bodies, right? So each one of these has, the first dip comes all the way down to here, and then a second dip about a third of the way down, okay? Here, you can, there's no different situation between the two, and then those teardrops definitely give you an idea that, yes, two layers of rutile on porcelain is going to run like hell. Stoneware, not so much. Porcelain has a lot more flux in it, and so that the clay is melting and sort of adding to the melting action of the glaze. Or that's not nearly happening as much on stoneware. And then somewhere in between is the white stone. Actually, that's porcelain as well, isn't it? So maybe a thinner two-dip situation here. Or no, somebody else did that. I'm not sure why it's there. And same, you know, here's a really great example of what happens with the different clays, right? So not nearly as runny, getting runnier, super runny. Okay, how to prepare for glazing, I think, is the first place to start. A lot of people are waxing their bottom. Fine to do if you have a hairy bottom. If you don't have a hairy... No, I'm sorry. I couldn't resist. I don't personally think that wax is necessary or worth the risk. It always goes somewhere I don't want it to go, so I usually don't do it. However, when I'm doing production mode and I've got 75 bowls to glaze or 100 bowls to glaze, I will take the time, and I usually use a banding wheel so I can turn the bowl and hold my brush on there with minimal amount of wax and just kind of touch that foot because it speeds it up a little bit. But I think that's the only thing that wax is really good for, is speeding up the process. Here with what we're doing, I don't think there's really much need to speed up the process. a sponge works really fine for wiping the bottom of a pot off. And I think that it actually does a better job and sort of ensures that the glaze isn't going to run onto the shelf, and I'll show you why. Okay. But first, I think it's an idea to talk about preparing the pot. This pot has been sitting out for a long time, right? Dusty. That is going to cause glaze defects every time if you leave that dust on the surface. So if you know that it's been sitting a while, it really is in your best interest to wipe that surface. And so I used one side for that side. I'm going to flip my sponge and try to use the cleaner side for this side and get much of that dust off. Now, sponging the dust off doesn't saturate the clay as much, right? The technology of glaze is that you have materials that are in suspension in water, right? Which is different than being in solution. The two Shinos have soluble salts, those are in solution, but everything else is in suspension. So bisqueware is still really porous, as we see, right? It absorbs water really fast, and so when you dip in, you're absorbing the water that's there, leaving that material that's in suspension stuck to the surface. If you get too much glaze on, some of you have maybe had the experience where my glaze isn't drying, why won't it dry? Well, it's not drying because the clay is saturated, or the bisque is saturated, and so it's going to have to evaporate slowly. And that's a real good indicator that you have too much glaze on your pot, and you maybe should think about washing it off, letting the pot dry for a day, and then reglazing. Now, if you throw really, really thin, it's going to take a while for your glazes to dry, and they might not be too thick, but because there's barely any clay there for the moisture to absorb into. So those are all things that you should think about. This, I wouldn't hesitate to glaze in maybe 15 minutes or something like that, because I think that the moisture I've pushed into the clay is going to evaporate in that amount of time. Had I ran it under the water to remove the dust, well, that would have saturated much, much more, and then I would wait at least a day to glaze. Okay. Here, where I've done some iron oxide work on this piece, the iron wash, right? You're familiar with that. I don't need to talk about that too much. painted it on, put a lot of moisture in doing that, wiped off a lot of it, put a lot of moisture in doing that. So I would wait a day to glaze this after I've iron oxided the surface.
But if you want to put like a thin layer of glaze, maybe it's a good idea to make it saturated with water a little bit.
Yes, that's a great point. If you wanted a thinner application, instead of thinning the glaze out, you might just saturate your pot a little bit, for sure. Like the yellow salt can look really nice when it's thin. And so, I would, and instead of using the sponge for that, I would pass it sort of quickly under the water and then go, wait for that surface to kind of clear, right? Or let the surface look like it's dry a little bit. You know it's not, but, and then go in and dunk. Yeah, for sure. The iron can be really nice under the clay, and I would say that you can get a bit of an idea of what it's going to do from the iron tile, the iron slip tile. You can also get a pretty good idea of what iron's going to do by looking at the grog stoneware, right? So, and comparing it, say you were using porcelain and you rubbed a bunch of iron into the surface. Well, your glaze might turn out a little bit more like the grog stoneware tiles do. Or at least it's a point of reference, right? The best example is probably the carbon trap Shino. You can see how it goes from no iron in the clay to a little bit, to more, to a lot. And so if had this been, this is white stone, but had it been porcelain, we might expect to see in these lighter areas something closer to this, in these darker ranges something closer to what that is. That sort of makes sense in a way, I think. Sandpaper. You know, you have one last opportunity to look for boogers on your pot, and here's a nice little dent. They sand out pretty easy. I got a bump on the lip up here that's really ugly. Sand them off. Again with the sponge. Blow the surface a little bit, and then just make sure you wipe that dust off. The glaze will want to crawl and kind of peel away from itself if there's dust on there. Also, if you just had a cheeseburger before you came to glaze your stuff, wash your hands. That grease is going to get onto the bisque, and that can cause glaze defects as well. So be mindful of those things. And especially if you're handling other people's bisqueware out on the table and moving things around, think about your hands and how clean they are. It can make a difference. Okay, where to go next? I don't know. So I've got some shapes here that sort of present different challenges. I also have some alternative wax. This wax is made by a company called Aftosa. It works really, really well on top of another glaze. Sometimes the wax, the cheapo wax that we buy here, if you put it on top of a glaze that you've already put on, it likes to kind of peel. Mm-hmm. You've seen that happen. This stuff won't do that as much. I keep a little bottle here. If you want to use it, you can. But I think you can go online to just about any ceramic supplier and find this Aftosa wax. Understand that it has a little bit of formaldehyde in it, so don't drink it or lick your fingers when you're done. It probably wouldn't be too bad. Probably.
Get back to us on that one.
Yeah, I'll try some later and see what happens.
You know, quick question. Yeah. Do you know if it peels when you scratch it, like if you try to do like a graffiti on it, would it peel off or?
No, it doesn't peel off. It actually absorbs into the bisqueware a little bit. If you put it right on the bisque, it absorbs in. And the only way to get it off again is to re-bisque fire.
I like that.
And you might have a tough time convincing
you buy it
Zach
online?
That that's worth his time to do. Sorry, go ahead.
Did you buy it online?
Yeah.
I have a question. Talk about it again. You talked about this before. When you're putting wax resist onto a piece and you want to put glaze over the top, you have to wait a little bit.
Yes. Yes.
How
yes. Long? You should, like with the wax here, I would put it on and wait at least a half an hour. This stuff, they recommend that you wait overnight. If you're going to put a glaze on top of it for it to work really well.
But you can put glaze on top of it?
The idea is that glaze won't stick to it.
Oh.
Right? Yeah. So, and what Char is suggesting and what she means by that question is that sometimes when you put wax on, and you of course are going to let it become dry to the touch before you glaze. But if you glaze too soon after you've applied the glaze won't peel off of it. It'll sort of stick to it because that surface is still kind of tacky and that wax hasn't cured enough.
Oh, so you don't want it to stick.
Right, that's why you're using it. Yep. So, just to do it, let's pour a little bit in here. The other nice thing about this is that it's green and you can see where it is.
And it stays green?
It stays green, yep. Also, I'm going to try and get Jesse to buy some of these foam brushes. They work so nice for putting wax on. Way better than the bristle brushes. It's way safer it doesn't run as much, or you can be a little more in control. The thing about them is that it's hard to get that wax wash out. And I suspect that's why we're not using foam ones, because you need hot water and soap and lots of scrubbing to get the wax out.
Could you put soap in that first before you dipped it in the to make it clean out again?
I don't know, maybe.
They used to teach us to do that with our brushes that we were painting.
Oh, yeah?
Wax resist was that you put a little bit of soap in the bristle.
Yeah.
It used to be wax resistant, and it came right out of the brush afterwards because it already had soap.
I will try that. It's a good idea. So the idea would be that you'd wax here where you don't want glaze to be, right? The foot is an obvious place. And this will help my demonstration with not, or my case for not waxing. So one thing that I've done here is made sure that I'm not just waxing the very terminal bottom, I'm waxing up the side a little bit too.
How much do you need to go up the side?
It's a good question.
It depends on
the situation. I think it depends. I think it depends a little bit. You know, here I would stop at that edge right there. But I would be careful not to get too much glaze down in that zone. And part of what I'm trying to get at with this idea of waxing is that if you don't wax, let's do one here. Clear, buttermilk, I don't know. Let's do. Let's do red. Red's a good example. Evan's red. Let me grab the stool. So, to sort of sidestep a little bit what I'm talking about, this Evans Red is a finicky one. Mix more than you think you should. You want to get anything that's settled out up from the bottom. If when you take the tip of the mixer and you kind of wipe it around on the bottom, if you come out with any sludge stuck to the tip of the mixer, you need to mix more. And then I always test the thickness of the glaze with my fingers. And so here we see my cuticle line showing through a little bit. To me, that's what I would say is an ideal glaze thickness for most glazes. The chinos should be a little thicker. You wouldn't want to see your skin at that cuticle line. So as you're glazing, I think it's a good idea to, you know, at least dip and get a frame of reference for, okay, this is how thick the glaze is. I'm going to do a dip and a half or two dips or whatever. And then when you get your result, you can say, okay, that's how it reacted at that thickness, or at least have a frame of reference for what it was that you started with. So next time when you approach the glaze and you stick your fingers in and you see that, oh my gosh, I can totally see my skin. It's not nearly as thick as it was before. I'm going to need to put on more or less depending on the result you're looking for. The red needs...
You've gotten rid of all the toxic glazes, so that's not a problem, right?
Well, they all have in their raw state like this, they're all sort of slightly toxic. Some are worse than others. We've done away with the materials that, you know, like barium glazes. Barium is not good for your system. But they all have some metallic oxides in them. You know, they're heavy metals. This one has copper in it. The blacks have cobalt, chromium, manganese, all of these things in your bloodstream cause some pretty weird neurological issues.
That's what's wrong with us, right?
Yes.
It's definitely what's wrong with me.
Well, I was going to say, the thing maybe, I work really hard to keep my hands out of the glaze.
The choices I made in my 20s have no bearing on how crazy I am now.
Yeah. Just think how long I've been doing it.
Yeah.
So instead of fingers, you can probably dip just a stick.
Well, it's now here's the thing. These materials are in suspension. Mm-hmm. The particle sizes are too large to go through the pores of your skin.
Okay.
If we were talking about materials in solution, that would be
sense.
A different thing.
It makes sense. Yeah.
But there's no way it's going to migrate through your skin. Now, if you have cuts or tears in your cuticles, especially in the wintertime, yeah, then there's an open line right into your bloodstream.
Yeah,
so you might want to put some gloves on. And we do have gloves over there right behind Brian. There's some wrist ones, and then Kim has brought in some shoulder length ones in case you really need to go in deep.
Are you helping a cow?
If you got a cow at home that has issues, you might want to grab some. Yeah. Or if you have problems with waxing your bottom. All good comedians bring things back like that a little later on. It's funnier.
And then there's you.
And then there's me. I'm from Minnesota, though. That's my excuse. Mm-hmm. Okay, sorry. Back to the red. The red, I think, is sort of one of the glazes that needs the most attention or the most talking about. It's the one that, okay, why is my red not red? Why is it blotchy? Why is it really red, but it ran off onto the shelf, right? And it's all about thickness with copper red. That red is only on the very surface of the glaze. If you were to take a sandblaster to it and blast through that very top layer, you'd see that the glaze underneath is blue. And it's that red only comes from the amount of carbon that's deposited on top of the glaze from the kiln firing. Pennies are a good example of that, right? A lot of times if you see a penny that's been sitting in water for a long time, it has turned blue. And that's in an oxygen-rich environment, you'll get blue. Now, if that penny was exposed to moisture in a non-oxygen situation, yeah, you'd see more of a red color coming out of it. But again, it's just on the surface, and so you've got to get that glaze just right.
So it's mostly copper.
Copper carbonate.
So if you want red, it should be thicker or thinner.
Well, I have a system that is based a little bit on what I find when I dip my fingers in there.
Okay.
And so right now, this is ideal for my system, right? And so my system for copper red is what I call a dip and a half. I'll show you what the dip and a half is. Because if you just, with this, the way the thickness is now, if you do one dip, mm-hmm. it's going to be pale and blotchy and not a nice red. If you do one dip, let it dry completely, and then another dip, mm-hmm. that's what I would call two dips, right? Mm-hmm. You're probably going to get too much, and it's going to run onto the kiln shelf and get underneath the pot and stick and chip on the edges and stuff. So a dip and a half seems to work really well, especially with this Evans Red. It can... Apparently there's dust in there. Use your clothes if you want.
Method number two.
You can see my shirts. My wife loves me. So usually the dip and a half is just perfect. And so what I do is, on things that I can grab with the tongs, dip, pull it out, it's going to be nice and glossy, wet. When it's dry, it's matte, chalky, right? But in between that wet and dry, there's a semi-matte stage where it goes from glossy to this sort of dull sheen. It's at that dull sheen that you want to dip again, and that's where that half of a dip comes in, the dip and a half, right? So we'll do that. So I don't linger at all. And so we're going from glossy, there's that sheen that I'm looking for, semi-matte glaze, or semi-matte state, a little bit of a, and then we can put that down there, let go carefully.
Do you just leave the little...
The tong marks?
Yes.
On this one, I scraped it a little bit when I let go, and so I will take my finger once it's totally dry and kind of rub that spot and push some of that powder into that little scrape mark. The little raised bumps that are there, I leave those usually because I don't care as much about that. You know, you might get a little bit of a color variation in those little spots. Especially with like the carbon traps, you know, you'll get a color shift because that glaze is so susceptible to thickness. It changes with every little bit of thickness. But yeah, I don't bother with them too much.
That's how you prove it's handmade anyway.
Yeah, you know, it's, yeah, I guess. Now, here's where we start coming into what I think about wax and no wax. Should leave this dry a little longer, maybe. There's that scrape right there. It's a little too wet to rub in there. So in that case, I just take a little of that thick glaze from the side of the bucket, just above the water line, that thick stuff, and then dip my finger into the glaze. And so there's a little bit there, and then just touch. So if you ever, you know, like if you get a little piece that chips off the lip accidentally, a little bit of that thick sludge, and then some of the regular glaze, and then just touch. If you try to wipe, it's not going to work very well. But, now, wax versus no wax. If I were to glaze this one, that wax is going to do a great job keeping the glaze off the foot. And I'll have to go back with a sponge and clean the little beads that are left behind. But usually, I'm not going to rub that edge. And what happens is that the glaze, as it's drying, kind of runs down and it collects just above that wax line. And so you get a little bit thicker glaze situation just above the wax line. That little bit of thickness can cause a bit of a run, and if it's real close to the bottom, yeah, it can get underneath and get onto the shelf and stick. In this situation, because I'm going to have to wipe it, I'll end up feathering that, you know, whatever glaze might kind of collect down near the bottom as it dries. As I'm wiping, I'm sort of feathering that edge back and creating a thinness that sort of leads up to the... That wasn't too hard, right? Some of the glazes don't come off as easy.
Now, if you let it dry more, do you still have it come off that easily, or do you have to work harder?
Some glazes dry stiffer than other glazes do. This one doesn't dry very stiff. It's pretty easy. Yeah, it might take a little more where you have to rinse. But again, you know, like, I don't know if any of us are in that much of a hurry. So now, because I know that I want that glaze to be gone up the side just a little bit, I'm going to work kind of right, letting the sponge sort of overlap the edge, right? So you see how that's coming off. I'll turn and see where the glaze is right up to the edge. But if I'm pushing more on the bottom, I'm not trying to push on the side at all. I'm just letting the sponge fold over. And by doing that, I'm actually removing that little bit of thickness, and I'm feathering that thickness back so it's a little bit thinner leading up to where the glaze stops. And a lot of times that can really make or break something that might run
And so can that be stopped from running? So again, I'm like I said, I'm not trying to wipe the sides, I'm just letting that sponge fall over. I really don't want to glaze this copper red.
Chad, if you were going to put a little bit of teal, let's say, around the lip of that one, would you let it dry completely?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, because I would hate to cross-pollinate the rutile. Not that that little bit would do much, but yeah.
Okay. The rest.
I guess if it showed a little bit of dampness still, it'd be okay. But definitely make sure that it's not gonna sort of wash off by dipping it into another glaze. Yeah. So now, with this special wax, it's pretty easy to come back in and set up a situation where you can put a cover glaze on and get a bit of a pattern going. Whereas it doesn't happen all the time, but I've seen the wax that we have just peel right up, especially if you try to do a big patch. It seems to like to peel a lot. Definitely wait for all of that wax to dry. And again, if you can wait overnight with this stuff, it's better. You get a better result. You know, here it's, you can tell that it's dry, but if you touch it, it's pretty tacky. By tomorrow morning, it'll be pretty smooth and a lot harder, right? So that tackiness is going to cause the glaze to stick to it a lot more. Did I do something? What's funny? It's tacky.
I figured it was from the user.
So that's the copper red. That dip and a half works really well for the Tomoku as well. You can ensure that you'll get a black instead of a matte brown. I would say that, you know, in a situation with the rutile blue, if you had porcelain, yeah, that second dip's a bad idea, but one might not be real effective, right? So you might want a little bit more. I always do a dip and a half when I'm dealing with celadons, right? It needs to be nice and rich. Sorry, I'm pointing down there, they're here. Oops. So, other options for glazing. I have grab the Shino. Oh, it's full. The two Shino glazes are really, really finicky when it comes to thickness. This one, the carbon trap, is the orangey one. On the porcelain, it's going to be real light. If you get two layers on, especially, you know, you can see the second layer here on this grogstoneware, which has the most iron in it, it's still going to go pretty white. White. And so you can play with that. You know, your first layer, nice and orange. Your second layer, after it totally dries, get your second layer on. Yeah, you can go into a white situation. Check the thickness on this one too. You know, if it's been sitting a long time, it can thicken. And so we'll see where it's at right now. Yeah.
a little bit thicker than what the copper red looked like. But still, I can see some definition in my skin, you know, see that skin showing through a little bit. If it covers your skin and all you see is glaze, you're going to get white, for sure. So this stuff, definitely, if you want it to be real orange, for sure, pass it under the sink quickly, and you'll get a thinner coat, right?
Chino, always bubbles.
Yep. And those bubbles can cause color shift. You know, you can see here where those bubbles sort of change the color a little bit. You get these little white halos in places. Doesn't always happen. But even here, you know, you can see where that bubble was right there. It's kind of orange where it was real thin on the edge too, where it was wiped away, where it gets real thin.
But it will show texture because of the different layers.
Yeah. Yeah, the chattering on the bottom of this bowl, you'll see more of the definition of that chattering because of the way that the glaze will settle into the deeper recesses and sort of peel away from the higher points. Did you have a more of a question about the bubbles?
Yeah, I was just wondering if should I wait till the bubbles
do. If you want a real smooth coat, you can wait a little bit, but know that the materials in suspension are settling.
Yeah.
The best way to deal with if you want a real smooth coat, is to let it dry and then take your finger and rub slightly over the surface and fill those little pocks in. Yeah.
Should I wait till it's dry?
Now, here I want the inside to be a little thinner. I'm gonna let the outside be a bit thicker, so I'm just gonna moisten the inside of the bowl. Make sure it's gonna fit. Now, because this is so touchy with thickness, if I just dip it in and pull it straight out, this leading edge is going to be in the glaze much longer than the tail and end of the bowl. And so you will get a whiter fading into oranger near the top. You'll get little streaks of white coming off of where the tongs are. You can battle that situation by immediately coming out and turning it the other direction, hoping to get some of that down the other. But, you know. Close one. So definitely there's some bubbles here on top for sure that are going to be almost no glaze where they are, so I would definitely go back when it's dry.
Now when you to combat the more glaze on one side, if you went back for a second dip, would you go hold it on the opposite side?
Well, yes. Yeah, that would be a good way to go about it. You'd get an even more even coat. On a bowl like this, or a plate, or something that goes in and back out, if you don't want that color shift, one idea then would be to take another container, pour your glaze in there, take your bowl and pull on the rim, and dip through there like that a couple of times, and you'll get a more even color glaze that way. Cups, you know, you're going to submerge the whole thing, twist it around in there a little bit and pull back out, and you're going to be a little bit more even with smaller objects that way. Let's see. I got dots. Dots work really nice, especially for the chinos. it feels cold, it's probably still wet. This feels pretty room temperature. I've learned to love these dots. They do, especially with the carbon trap, they do really neat stuff.
It's cool.
So, because the Shino has soluble salts in it, those salts, as the glaze dries and the moisture evaporates, that moisture is carrying those salts with it. And so you can get results from that those salts migrating around. And the dots kind of allow that to happen nicely. In this situation, I'll pour the inside first. Cleanliness purposes, you know, if I were to fill this up with orange juice, I'd want it to be able to clean it using just maybe really hot water.
Okay.
Where if it was bare clay in there, I don't know if there's chunks that were I won't be able to get up clean very well. So the glaze allows the stuff to release. Some people that are Shino crazy will glaze the inside. Let it dry overnight, let those salts migrate through the clay, and then glaze the outside on a separate day. Or I know I've seen people try where they glaze the